As a United Nations Security Council sanctions team is all set to visit Pakistan, and the full import of President Trump's tweet and decision to suspend military aid to Pakistan is still being understood, will anything substantive change, or is this more of the same? Our newsmaker this week is Husain Haqqani, outspoken author, commentator, analyst, who has been rather prophetic about his home country in more ways than one. You've been asked this before, including by me, and one of the things you pointed out was that a cut or a suspension in military aid by the United States of America to Pakistan by itself is not enough. And I think you made the very important point that if anyone were to just do their homework, aid cuts have happened before. $800 million by the Obama administration right after Osama bin Laden was taken out of Pakistan, for example. Why should we see President Trump's decision or response to Pakistan as making a departure from the past?
I think what must be taken into account is that President Trump is not acting just impulsively alone. Something has built up over the years. The fact that President Bush's efforts of incentivizing Pakistan into changing its position, President Obama's effort at offering incentives first and then coercion later, that hasn't worked. So now the American system, so to speak, is willing to look at alternatives. Of course, there are the usual voices, and you've probably seen them in the media saying, well, Pakistan is too important, so we can't take a risk. Yes, they are not keeping their promises. They are not our allies in the real sense, but we have no choice but to keep engaged with them. And then there are those who are saying, you can keep engaged with Pakistan, but at the same time recognize that you will not succeed in Afghanistan as long as Pakistan continues to support the Taliban. If it acts as the arsonist and fire brigade both at the same time, the fire is not going to go out. And more important than that, there are voices like mine, which is, this is not about punishing Pakistan or Pakistanis. I'm a Pakistani, I care about Pakistan. It is about changing mindsets in Pakistan. So I think that the cumulative effect of all that, plus President Trump's own instincts about matters such as this, there is an opportunity for, from the point of view of those who want to change US policy.
But break it down into specifics. When you and Lisa Curtis co-wrote a seminal paper on Pakistan, the Hudson Institute paper, which all of us have read, there were two, three very interesting points you make. You first said that America has to understand Pakistan is not an ally. You said that the option must be kept open of Pakistan being declared a terrorist state at some point. And most significantly, if someone were to just dig up that paper, you actually said that America must retain the option to directly target safe havens of terrorism inside Pakistan, that Afghan Taliban safe havens as they have existed must not enjoy that sort of impunity. Are you then, Husain Haqqani, making the point that it's that use of force is very much on the table for the Trump administration, a la the Osama bin Laden operation?
Well, let's start right at the top. The first point about that the American alliance with Pakistan is actually over. Why? What makes nations allies? It's a shared interest or a shared enemy? Well, in this case, there is no shared interest because Pakistan's powerful elite, the military, the intelligence service, and even some civilians think that having a quote-unquote friendly Afghanistan basically means having Pashtun Islamists in authority in Afghanistan. They tried it with Hikmatyar in the 90s, then with the Taliban, and now they are doing it with the Taliban and the Haqqani network. That is not an American interest. The American interest in South Asia is also to eliminate terrorism. Pakistan has not embraced that as a national
policy.
So
you're saying Pakistan and America have absolutely competing interests in Afghanistan?
And I was coming to the third point. Not only Afghanistan, there is a bigger picture emerging. The US Defense Department has now announced its new strategic outlook, in which they say we are not going to be narrowly focused on terrorism as America's main enemy. We are going to go back to the potential of being challenged by rising alternative superpowers, which basically means China and Russia and their
all of which
alliance.
Is true, but you haven't answered my question. Your own paper recommended that for American policy to be effective vis-a-vis Pakistan, cutting of aid by itself is not enough.
That you and I agree on.
You agree on that still? You stand
cutting
by
of
those comments?
Cutting of aid alone will not work. But
are you therefore recommending hot pursuit of safe havens?
Look, I'm not recommending anything specific right now. Let me explain the context. So if you are not allies, then the constraints on your policy and your actions that comes from having a country as an ally, then those constraints are removed. That includes hot pursuit, because you don't do hot pursuit with an ally. You basically call an ally and say, hey, bad guys are coming your way, can you deal with them? That changes. So the opportunity of hot pursuit arises from the
American. So this is very important. You're saying the first thing America has to recognize is Pakistan's not an ally. When America officially in its system acknowledges that, then the hot pursuit option is more easily placed on the table, because you don't owe it the same answers that you would have to an ally.
Absolutely. Similarly, for example, drone strikes previously, because you were conducting drone strikes in territory of an ally, you were bound by the restrictions the ally put on them. So they were what were known as boxes. You can do them only in these boxes along the border in the tribal areas. Already the Trump administration has done at least 7 drone strikes that have been outside the old boxes. They have been further deep. Now there is always the chance that something like this could hurt Pakistan, could hurt Pakistanis at a level at which the Americans may not want to do right now, and they shouldn't. And yet it could serve as a wake-up call in Pakistan's calculus. It would have to matter that, do we want America? Okay, we were bad allies, but we were still allies. Do we want America to look upon us as an adversary? And the Americans also, those who want restraint, they are saying, do we want Pakistan as an adversary? So all of those calculations may actually result in a little more give from the Pakistani side than we have seen in the past.
So let me understand this in simpler terms for those of our viewers who may not be as deeply into this foreign policy dimension of India, Pakistan, America as we are. You are saying aid cut by or suspension of military aid by itself is not likely to make Pakistan change. Agreed?
Yes.
You are saying you can be engaged with Pakistan without considering it an ally.
Absolutely.
You are saying once you stop looking at Pakistan as an ally, other options, including drone strikes and possible hot pursuit options, are more easily on the table to use when needed. Yes?
Absolutely. And more than that. I mean, then it becomes, for example, targeted sanctions against individuals from the security services. You can't do those to an ally.
Targeted sanctions against
security
members
service,
of Pakistani
members,
security establishment.
Services, yeah.
Give me an example of somebody you think could be targeted.
So I'll give you an example. So supposing Mr. A, American records, telephone intercepts, etc., prove that Mr. A was involved in the planning of an attack on the U.S. Embassy in Kabul. Targeted sanctions would mean that Mr. A's assets, Mr. A's travel around the world, etc., etc., would all be targeted by America for restrictions. And that actually is a big thing. If you realize, Pakistan has fought back even restrictions on Masood Azhar from the UN, etc., with the help of China. Why? Because the more your individual citizens are targeted, the more the narrative builds and the recognition comes from the international community that your country has people in it who are free and who operate openly, who are terrorists. And Pakistan doesn't want that. So if the sanctions are against individuals who have titles, formal titles, official titles,
in the military or the secret covert agencies,
serving or retired, either way, it is really, really taking things one step further. And when I was talking about Pakistan not being an ally, the third and the most important thing about what has changed is that the American government and President Trump in particular, but the rest of the American system also, has become very clear about one thing. China is not somebody that they trust. India, they look upon as the potential ally and partner. India might not want to be an ally, it wants to be a partner. They don't like the word ally. for stewardship of the Indo-Pacific. There also, Pakistan and America's interests no longer coincide. So Pakistan has to rethink completely. Do we want to go from our 70-year embrace of Uncle Sam to a new embrace of Auntie China? And in the process, just because we hate brother India or neighbor India, or do we want to reconsider all our foreign policy options? It's not going to happen quickly.
So let's talk about China first. There is an increasing perception, and there are naysayers of the Trump approach to Pakistan who are arguing that you've actually pushed Pakistan closer into the embrace of China. They point out that the CPEC, the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, in itself is bringing billions of dollars of infrastructure into Pakistan, that Pakistan has become a virtual colony, a neo-colony of China. And therefore, does that suit strategic interests of both India and America? Is there a China factor that one has to weigh?
First of all, Pakistan is as close to China as can be. CPEC was planned and its execution started long before President Trump said anything about Pakistan. I think we sometimes forget about fundamentals while discussing foreign policy. We all get carried away by the news of the day. So China and Pakistan, let's be honest, forget about today's headlines or yesterday's headlines. China and Pakistan have been close for many, many years. American intelligence has sometimes expressed the view that China provided Pakistan with important designs, etc., relating to their nuclear weapons program. How close do you have to be able to do that? In violation of international restrictions, a bit like North Korea, where China has broken international restrictions. So if they did that, then basically China and Pakistan are as close as they can be. Question is, does the Pakistani elite now want to go and holiday in Beijing rather than in New York and London? The question is, do they want their children to go and study in Shanghai and Fudan University rather than at Harvard and Oxford? I don't think that time has come yet. Now, I am not advocating that Pakistan or Pakistanis should be punished. I am only saying, analytically, what might change their minds? Pakistan as a nation has wasted 70 years by thinking of its national purpose as being competition with India, getting Kashmir, restricting India in everything. If any other country talks about India becoming a UN Security Council permanent member, Pakistan's the one that says they shouldn't be. Nuclear suppliers group, Pakistan says we don't want them there. Even if you put us there, no, shut them. Is that a worthy enough a national purpose? At the time of partition, Pakistan and India had a 2% difference in their literacy rates. That difference is now 20%. Pakistan is the sixth largest country in the world by economic size. It has the world's sixth largest army, 11th most powerful army by firepower, and yet it is the 26th largest economy by PPP basis and 42nd in terms of nominal GDP. None of those indicators show that Pakistan is moving forward.
But none of Pakistan's, or many of Pakistan's responses, and when I say Pakistan, I have to clarify, I don't mean people.
You mean the Pakistani elite.
I mean the ordinary establishment. Yeah. I mean the Pakistani Fair establishment, enough. Those yeah. who wield power.
So do I, because the average person of Pakistan deserves to be given a chance.
And so I'm not, I think India has officially, I remember Prime Minister Modi officially drawing that distinction inside Parliament between the Pakistani people and the Pakistani deep state, right? Or the Pakistani state in some cases. Now, my question is this. None of this, and India has seen this more than any part of the world, none of this has made Pakistan change, and there could be a reason for it. That all of this falls to smithereens as long as America continues to have a mess in Afghanistan, which it believes it needs Pakistan help for.
Is that Pakistan's deep state and Pakistan's establishment has been able to have its cake and eat it too, which is why they haven't changed. Now, let us understand. Americans started depending too heavily on the ground lines of communications and air lines of communications. There was a perception that, without Pakistan's help, how can we supply our troops in Afghanistan? And as long as we have a problem with Iran. But several things.
And the problem with Iran is worsening.
Sure.
Under the Trump administration is going to be much more.
But certain things have changed.
Iran than Obama.
Certain things have changed. First, they have fewer troops. So when you have fewer troops, you have less equipment and material to send. Second, President Trump is considering increasing America's overall defense budget. So therefore, the constraints of cost, because you can supply anything anywhere in the world in the 21st century, it's always a matter of cost. And America, in the Cold War, for example, when they decided that they're going to do the Berlin airlift, they didn't take into account the cost. It was the political decision. If America makes a political decision, then they will be able to supply their troops.
So you're actually saying stop depending, NATO troops should stop depending on supply lines through Pakistan, move to either airdrop supplies or through Central Asia.
Although I am told that the Pakistani authorities, during the recent visit of the acting Assistant Secretary of State, assured them that we are not going to shut down these line of communications because Pakistan also have economic benefits.
But we have seen in the past
that
these supply lines have been shut down. And if Pakistan is pushed beyond, beyond this AIDS cut, you could see that happening. So one, the US needs a different supply route.
I think they have already worked that out. They will keep using the Pakistani supply route as long as they can. But if they have to, I think that they are prepared for the eventuality that this may not be the necessary supply route. More important, as I keep saying, the real challenge for the Trump administration is to persuade the Pakistanis that, you know what, you can no longer be in the old position where you can actually have both sides of the equation. You have to decide. And I have a feeling that there is a decision emanating from Pakistan. I don't know if you've noticed, for example, on Hafiz Saeed. Previously, it used to be, well, we are trying, but we are not succeeding, we are making an effort. Now it's no, we are not even going to try. Now the Prime Minister is saying we have no evidence against
things like that. I was going to say to you that the reason that so many of us are cynical and is, because of terrorists like Hafiz Saeed, the Prime Minister of Pakistan goes on national television in Pakistan, refers to Hafiz Saeed as Sahib, says there's no case against him. Though the Pakistan government has at least told the judiciary that please don't allow him to contest elections. But he's still getting deference. He still, roams around with impunity.
A most interesting thing is that there's no case against me either. But the Prime Minister is unlikely to come on television and say Husain Haqqani Sahib has no case against him, so he's welcome to come back to Islamabad tomorrow. That doesn't happen. That's the situation. That's the reality of
Pakistan. So Husain Haqqani can't go home to Pakistan. Husain Haqqani can't contest an election, but Hafiz Saeed can demand to contest an election and can be called Sahib.
And Husain Haqqani right now probably doesn't want to go and doesn't want to contest an election, and Hafiz Saeed probably does. Bottom line.
But does that dichotomy capture for you the crisis of Pakistan?
It does. It always has. I've always made the argument that Malala Yousafzai can't go back. Forget about Husain Haqqani. I'm too small a person. Malala Yousafzai is Pakistan's only Nobel laureate in the peace realm. And she is an icon in the world. There are many people who are respected outside of Pakistan, but in Pakistan they are painted as enemies of Pakistan. That basically shows that Pakistan is actually isolated in a certain way already. Pakistan people are not even fully informed about how Pakistan is actually not seen globally with the kind of respect that Pakistanis deserve.
So there's still delusion or denial.
There is a lot of delusion and denial, and Hafiz Saeed,
want to ask you about Hafiz Saeed. I want to come back to Hafiz Saeed as well, because no less than a former president and a former army chief of Pakistan, General Pervez Musharraf, who by the way called you a traitor, and you must be used to being described like that.
But I could return the favor, but I'm too polite to...
Why don't you return the favor in this
situation? Well, I will say that in case of General Musharraf, there is a case of both treason, violation of the constitution, pending in Pakistan, and he hasn't faced those proceedings. So it would behove him to restrain his choice of words. But you know what? He's an elderly gentleman who can't come to terms with his not being in the limelight anymore. And so I really don't grudge him trying to get attention by saying the most outrageous things, including things he said in defense of Hafiz Saeed, even though his government, while he was in power, was the first one to put restrictions on Hafiz Saeed.
But now he is saying that he is the biggest supporter of Hafiz Saeed, and if Hafiz Saeed is allowed to contest elections, he would like to tie up with the front organization of the Lashkar. So now, as an Indian, here's how I'm connecting these dots. The Pakistan military actually intercedes with Nawaz Sharif when Nawaz Sharif is prime minister, allows Musharraf to leave the country even while he's being, tried in the Bukti murder case and Benazir Bhutto case. There's so many cases where,
And the most important case, the violation of the Pakistani constitution by making a coup. That is a very important thing too. In any country, anybody who totally violates the constitution must be punished.
But the Pakistan military protects its own. He was their former chief. He's allowed to leave. He's now talking again of contesting elections and time. And he as a former army chief and president of Pakistan, is calling himself the greatest supporter of the Lashkar-e-Taiba. How is an Indian, forget an Indian, how is anybody supposed to make sense of this?
Well, there is no sense to it. Look, every country likes, look, how do countries become strong? How did the state come about? Now, I don't want to go into Professor mode to talk about the Westphalian system and nation states, but a nation state has absolute monopoly or tries to have monopoly over coercive power. So there is an army in Pakistan. The word Lashkar means army. So why should there be another army? And for a former army chief to think of an illegitimate group, a private group, and a group that is recognized as a terrorist group by the rest of the world, to call that and say we need it, is absolute undermining of the state of Pakistan. The state of Pakistan should have its regular army, which should be subject to normal discipline under the constitution. It should be under civilian control like every other army in the world is. And these groups that call themselves armies of whatever, they should all be not only outlawed but demobilized and their weapons taken away, because that is how societies become civilized.
Why do you think no government in Pakistan has been able to stop Hafiz Saeed?
I think that it has to do with the lack of will on the part of our security establishment. What Musharraf is saying reflects the views of many in our security establishment. They really are obsessed with taking back, taking Kashmir. Now, my view on Kashmir, as you well know, and I've said it to you, to many others, that it is a dispute that at this stage is not resolvable. And when you don't have a dispute that is irresolvable, then the best course is have friendship first. To say it in Urdu or Hindi, I would say, pehle dosti, phir mushkilon ka hal. Instead, the Pakistani establishment says, no, we need victory in Kashmir. They can't get victory in a conventional war now that both countries have nuclear weapons. So asymmetric warfare. So therefore Hafiz Saeed is convenient. Now, unfortunately, they call him a freedom fighter, but by any definition of freedom fighter in the world, the freedom fighter belongs to the territory he or she is fighting for. Hafiz Saeed is a Punjabi from Pakistani Punjab. How can he be a Kashmiri freedom fighter? So he doesn't fit any category, which is why he is a terrorist. Now, I understand the demand for evidence. Question is, there must be
2611 tapes.
And there is the
and hundreds of other.
And there is the evidence that is available with the United Nations, with the US, with the. Why has Pakistan failed to convince the rest of the world that what you call evidence is not evidence? In any case, in a terrorism case, intelligence becomes evidence.
So I want to ask you something. You said in passing, there seems to be a message emanating from Pakistan. Are you reading that that Pakistan is heading somehow back to the future, as it were, that the embrace of Hafiz Saeed Sahib, as the Pakistani Prime Minister called him, the belligerent response to Donald Trump.
It's defiance. It's an attempt to try and convince the Americans that you lose us, we are so important. Look, part of it is psychological. Pakistanis have convinced themselves, and in my book, Magnificent Delusions, I make this point, they've convinced themselves that we are at the crossroads of Central Asia, Middle East, and South Asia. We are the most important country geopolitically and geostrategically. So nobody can afford to lose us. And if America goes now, China and Russia are immediately anxious to embrace us. You see that in the Pakistani press all the time. And who needs America? The assumption is that they don't say that because they really don't want America in, because they understand that having America as your partner has advantages way beyond the very specific matter. As I said, do they want to? I don't think the Pakistani elite is going to queue outside the Chinese embassy to get visas, but they do queue outside the American visa to get American embassy
but
to get
visas. But clearly
visa.
There is a view.
What they are trying to do is they are trying to message to the Americans that, you know what, you're not paying us attention, we don't need you either. It's a psychological warfare. I don't see that succeeding, at least with President Trump.
Okay, so that's where I'm going to push you on that, because there are clearly voices in the American establishment that also believe that, like any country would, that America has to follow its own own interests. And beyond a point, India believes America is not going to fight our battle. And let me give you an example. Last year, senators were prevailed upon, reportedly by the Pentagon, to drop a clause that made funding to Pakistan or aid to Pakistan conditional on cracking down on two networks, two terror networks. One was the Haqqani network, one was the Lashkar-e-Taiba. That was there in the original
They decoupled them. They said, don't do it together,
Lashkar was separate. Yeah. Lashkar was just dropped. So in simple terms, the Americans are basically saying, hang on, you need to crack down on the Haqqani network in Afghanistan because that hurts American
so
troops.
So let me explain to you why that was done.
But the Lashkar, which is the primary, one of the primary terror groups that hits Indians, that was, so this is back to a good terrorist, bad terrorist policy.
So actually, no. It was an attempt to try and give Pakistan an out.
A wiggle room.
And sometimes you need to give wiggle room to prove that there is no wiggle room.
Right.
So the fact that Pakistan didn't take that bait, that they didn't say, okay, we'll act against the Haqqani network if you don't push us on these people, and these people too, we will, which is what Musharraf, who's lying through his teeth now, as he has done through most of his life, at that time also did this after 9/11. Then he bought time, he got time, and then in that everything was restored, and the Taliban became active again, even after having helped them bomb them and arrest many of their leaders. Even the Taliban ambassador to Pakistan, who had been recognized as ambassador in violation of all international norms, he was handed over by Pakistani intelligence services to the Americans to send to Guantanamo, and he has written a whole book about it. So my point is that to make the point that Pakistan has an opportunity to try and do that, and just to show that they are not doing it, so that that enhances the ability of the White House to actually prevail upon everybody and convince those people within the State Department, within the Pentagon, who still have any residual soft spot for Pakistan because of having been an ally. Look, even people who've been married for a long time and have bitter divorces, they sometimes still have a soft spot for the other party just because of the long relationship they have had.
Or Stockholm syndrome.
So there are a lot of people in America who think, you know what, but give them a chance. So they said, okay, we gave them a chance. They didn't take it. Now we can actually come down with an even heavier hand.
Why would Trump be any different?
First of all, we must understand that President Trump does not get into nuance. He is a relatively straight calculator. Second, he sees the economic dimension as far more important. So, Indian companies are active in America. India is a source of jobs for Americans. India is a future economic partner. He sees no benefit in Pakistan. Now, I'm not saying that he shouldn't.
But what about dependency?
I'm just explaining.
Are you saying America is ready to shed its dependency on Pakistan in Afghanistan?
Absolutely. I think that the mood in Washington, D.C. is that there are the people who still have old think. But the new think is we have to find an outcome in Afghanistan in which we don't completely depend on somebody that we have not been able to depend on successfully for so long. Why is there a problem in Afghanistan? The Soviets left in 1989.
Yeah.
Then America and Pakistan diverged on who should lead Afghanistan. America would have been happy to have a broad coalition of people running Afghanistan. Pakistan wanted to impose Hekmatyar on Afghans. That didn't work. Civil war happened and Pakistan's side didn't win in the beginning until the Taliban. America had pulled out. So nowadays, the propaganda you hear on Pakistan, but America created the Taliban. America had nothing to do with the Taliban. It had to do something to do with the Mujahideen out of whom the Taliban came. Pakistan has been pushing this for so many years. And the Americans have gone along with Pakistan, thinking that maybe the Pakistanis will deliver some solution in Afghanistan.
Okay, last question. India-Pakistan. Engagement continues. The NSAs have had back channels open. The dialogue is frozen. There is a sense that there's absolute stasis between the two countries. Is that an inevitability given the, you know, given the impunity around Hafiz Saeed to start with?
Well, first of all, we must remember India and Pakistan are neighbors. We are not going away for one another.
Yeah.
At the same time, Pakistan has defined its national purpose, as I said earlier, with India as its permanent enemy. India has made efforts to try and overcome that. Pakistan has its own set of grievances. At the moment, I think that what we are going to see is a very measured approach from India, and we are seeing that.
Yeah.
And I think that Prime Minister Modi did the right thing, that he went to Pakistan to show to Pakistani people that somebody whom you see as a representative of Hindutva and therefore not necessarily favorably disposed to, even I am willing to come to Islamabad, to Lahore, shake hands with Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif, hug him, go along with him. But the ball is now in your court.
Yeah.
And I think that India's refusal to go back to business as usual is part of the effort to try and tell the people of Pakistan that there are problems on your side that you need to resolve. And I think it's not just India. The international community is telling Pakistan that the stories you tell each other, the stories your television anchors tell you every day, they are not the reality. For example, all nations that have had disputes have always tried to have normal relations before they can solve the disputes. Alsace-Lorraine, Russia, Germany and France fought many wars. In the end, how was it resolved? It was resolved by becoming closer, as they have become in the European Union. Pakistan and India too do not need to solve their problems and resolve disputes first. No dispute is going to be resolved through terrorism.
Yeah.
Nowhere have terrorists been able to win completely. The Basque terrorists have been around for a long time. Irish Republican Army.
Yeah.
Nobody prevailed. In the end, you have to talk. And so, Hafiz Saeed will probably have a big funeral in Lahore when he dies. He will certainly not be marching through Srinagar victorious. Can the Pakistani people understand it and accept it? It'll take time. As a Pakistani, I'm talking to them. You guys can keep talking to them. But it may be a longer time before we can reimagine Pakistan and give Pakistan a totally new outlook. Then I think we can have a South Asian era of cooperation that will probably be like the cooperation that we see in Europe, in ASEAN, and in North America.
The cynic in me says that is many decades away, may not even be in our lifetime.
I'm not cynical, but even I would say that it may take a long time, and sometimes it can happen very quickly. Just an anecdote, when the Soviet Union was collapsing, there were all these people who had predicted that the Soviet Union had now reached its most stable point. So change came in Eastern Europe when people were assuming that there is no potential for change and the conflicts have all frozen. You never know. Ideally, we should move the ball deliberately towards peace. We don't see that happening, and it's unfortunate.
Well, pleasure to have you as a newsmaker this week. We look forward to your next book, Reimagining Pakistan. At the moment, the story out of Pakistan is bleak and extremely worrying to Indians, as it should be to many people in the world. Husain Haqqani, thank you so much for talking to us.